गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, माय सेल्फ डॉक्टर प्रसन्ना जी पागा, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर ईएनसी डिपार्टमेंट एनएमआईटी बेंगलोर. आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू दिस वीटू ई शिक्षण प्रोग्राम ऑन माइक्रोवेव एंड एंटेना मॉड्यूल 3 लेक्चर 2. सो टुडे विल बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द माइक्रोस्ट्रिप ट्रांसमिशन लाइन्स विद स्पेशल एम्फोसिस ऑन द लॉसेस. सो इन द प्रीवियस क्लास यू हैव सीन दैट हाउ ए माइक्रोस्ट्रिप लाइन इज गोइंग टू बी मॉडल्ड, how we derived an empirical expression for the characteristic impedance of a microstrip transmission line, taking the wire over ground line as an example, as our reference, and then we modified that equation and finally arrived at the characteristic impedance. And we also did some problems to support the characteristic impedance of the microstrip transmission line. In today's class, we will primarily discuss about the losses. So these are the contents. So we are going to discuss about the attenuation losses that takes place inside the microstrip line, because there is a ground plane, on top of it there is a substrate and there is a conductor. So there will be losses taking place on the surface of the conductor, that you call it as attenuation losses. Then there will be dielectric losses which will be taking place inside the dielectric material. Then there will be radiation losses and ohmic losses as well. So they take place on the surface of the conductor. So we'll look into all these losses. Learning objectives. So students will be able to learn the different types of losses that are going to be present inside a microstrip transmission line, derive an empirical expression for each one of these losses in terms of the fundamental parameters such as your permittivity, permeability, thickness, substrate thickness, and all those things. Then also study the variation of these losses as a function of the geometry of the line. Okay. So again, first we'll go with the attenuation losses. So attenuation losses, the attenuation loss of a microstrip line depends on primarily three factors. One is the geometrical factors, that are such as length, width, height, substrate thickness, and all those things. Then the electrical properties of the substrate and the conductor, and the frequency of operation. So these are the three parameters on which primarily the attenuation losses depend on. So now let us consider this microstrip transmission line. As you can see, this is the microstrip transmission line with the substrate thickness of h. This is your ground plane. So on top of this substrate, a copper conducting strip is going to be mounted, which has got a finite thickness of t, and w represents the width of the microstrip transmission line. So once this line is going to be excited, okay, you see that there will be electric fields and magnetic fields which will be surrounding this copper conducting strip. So normally the magnetic field will be parallel to the electric field lines. So that means they will be distributed in the form of a concentric circles. Some of these field lines will be attracted towards the ground plane, and some of these field lines will be radiated into a free space. So normally, if the material is made up of a non-magnetic type, then there are two types of losses. One is the dielectric losses which occur within a substrate, and ohmic losses which occur on the conductor surface and the ground plane. So these are the two types of losses that takes place if the material happens to be a non-magnetic type. And the sum of these two losses are also expressed as loss per unit length in terms of the attenuation factor alpha. So there are two alphas, one corresponding to ohmic losses and other corresponding to the dielectric losses. So the power, now we have assumed that this is your microstrip transmission line. Okay, so this microstrip transmission line is actually carrying your signal from one point to another point. So now we have assumed that the direction of the propagation is z direction. Okay, this is your microstrip transmission line. Okay, this is z direction. This is x direction. This is y direction. Okay. So what you can see here is, so the direction of the propagation is z. Once the microstrip transmission line is going to be excited by applying a electric field at this particular point through the port, you see that there is a propagation of the wave that takes place inside the microstrip line. This is how the wave propagation takes place. Okay, from the source, from the reference point to the end of the microstrip transmission line. So the power is given by half into V into I conjugate, or I can write this as half into V plus e power minus alpha z into I plus e power minus alpha z, because V plus represents the incident voltage at this particular point, and I plus represents the incident current at this particular point. and alpha represents the attenuation constant. So this minus alpha z represents the wave is propagating along z direction with an attenuation constant of alpha. So it's a decaying exponential. So you see that the wave progressively goes on decreasing in amplitude as it moves along the transmission line. So I can write this I plus as V plus by Z naught. I can write I plus as V plus by Z naught. Then in that case, the power is given by V by I. V into power is V into I conjugate. So you know V plus e power minus alpha Z, I plus you can substitute as equal to V plus e power V plus by Z naught into e power minus alpha Z. So when you multiply these two terms, you get half into modulus of V plus whole square divided by Z naught into e power minus 2 alpha Z, because this is also e power minus alpha Z, this is also minus e power alpha Z minus alpha Z. So the exponents are going to be added up, so it will be e power minus 2 alpha Z. So this is the total power that gets dissipated or gets transmitted over a microstrip transmission line. So in other words, this P can be written as P naught e power minus 2 alpha Z. I am representing this as the power P naught. Okay, this is your power P naught. This is your power P naught. Okay, which is equal to V plus whole square modulus of V plus whole square divided by 2 Z naught into e power minus 2 alpha Z. This is your P naught into e power minus 2 alpha Z. So this is the initial, this is the power, that dissipation that takes place. Then the attenuation constant. To find out the attenuation constant, what you should do is you should differentiate the above equation with respect to Z. So if you differentiate the above equation with respect to Z, you get P is equal to P naught e power minus alpha, e power minus 2 alpha Z, right? E power minus 2 alpha Z. Differentiate this with respect to Z, what do you get? Dp by dz. So dp by dz is equal to P naught into d by dz of e power minus 2 alpha Z. Okay, so this comes out to be equal to minus 2 alpha e power minus 2 alpha Z into P naught. This you multiply it with P naught. So finally, okay, this is what you are going to get. So dp by dz, so alpha I have to find out. So alpha you take it to the LHS, then this becomes equal to minus of dp by dz. This will be the numerator divided by minus 2 p naught into alpha minus 2 p naught into e power minus 2 alpha z . This is nothing but your P offset. So this is nothing but your P offset. So I am replacing this particular term, okay, P naught e power minus 2 alpha z, with P offset. So the expression for alpha becomes equal to minus dp by dz divided by 2 into P offset. This is 2 into P offset. So I can write this as alpha is equal to minus of dp by dz divided by 2 into p of z, where p of z represents the power traveling along the positive z direction. Now again, this is the expression for attenuation constant. Since this microstrip line has got a conductor on top, so this is a conductor on top, isn't it? This conductor is made up of copper normally, okay. So this is your conductor, okay. So this is your conductor, so which is made up of copper, so definitely there will be loss taking place on top of this, that we are going to call as alpha d, alpha c, which is the attenuation constant due to conductor losses. And there is a dielectric here, this is your dielectric, okay. This dielectric has got certain permittivity, so which we are going to call it as epsilon r, okay. So normally what happens is there will be loss taking place inside this dielectric as well, and that loss is going to be modeled as alpha d. That corresponds to loss taking place inside the dielectric substrate, which is alpha d. So you have alpha c, which is the attenuation constant or the loss taking place on the surface of the conductor due to the wave propagating on the surface, and also you have loss taking place inside the dielectric substrate, and which is modeled by alpha d. So you have alpha is the total attenuation constant, which is the sum of alpha c and alpha d. Now power dissipation per unit length can also be written as half into Ri into I conjugate plus half into sigma v into v conjugate. So normally what happens is this is your power that dissipates on the conductor part, and this is the power that dissipates on the dielectric part. That means this portion of the power is going to be dissipated inside the dielectric, where sigma represents the conductivity of the dielectric, okay. So that is very important. So we can represent this in terms of the conductivity also. So sigma v into v conjugate, because it is v square by r, isn't it? So 1 by r is again sigma. So it is power dissipated. This gives the power, average power dissipated inside the dielectric. This is the average power dissipated inside the conductor. So finally, I can write this as half into I square r plus half into modulus of v square into sigma. Okay. So this is also given by Pc plus Pd. Pc represents the power dissipated inside the conductor, and Pd represents the power dissipated inside the a dielectric. So this is your conductor, this is your dielectric part. So this is your conductor part. And this is the dielectric, power dissipated on inside the dielectric. So now the dielectric losses, can also be expressed as alpha d. Alpha d is again equal to Pd divided by 2 into P of z. What I am doing here is, earlier I had written just P, isn't it? If you look at the previous expression, alpha d is equal to Pd divided by 2 into P of z, where Pd is the power dissipated inside the dielectric and P of z is the power that is flowing along the microstrip transmission line. So this is this gives me alpha d, and alpha c is given by approximately Pc divided by 2 into P of z, where Pc represents the power dissipated on the conductor surface and P of z represents the power propagating along the microstrip transmission line. So since the power is assumed to be flowing in the z direction, so we are assuming that it is a function of z. So that's why I have written it as Pc divided by 2 into P of z. So this is, these are the two expressions for alpha d and alpha c. Now our aim is to find out these two constants, alpha d and alpha c. So let us see one by one. So now we will try to find out an expression for alpha d. As I have told you, alpha d is the attenuation constant inside the dielectric, because there is a loss taking place inside the dielectric. So again, what happens is, whenever this microstrip transmission line is going to be excited by applying a voltage or current, you see there are two important quantities that need to be taken into account. So one is, when I apply a voltage here, okay, there will be a current which will be flowing here. Okay, this current gives rise to what is known as the conduction current density, JC. And again, what happens is there will be a displacement of the charges. That means there will be electric field lines which will be attracted towards the ground plane, which I already showed. Okay, that is due to the displacement of the charges, which is known as the displacement current density JD. Okay, you have JC as well as JD. Okay, JD represents the displacement current. This is the current due to the flow of electric current from the conductor to the ground plane via dielectric. Okay, that is known as the JD current. So again, what happens is, if you look at this figure, okay, this figure is going to give me an estimation of the relationship between JC and JD. There will be a phase lag, phase difference between the conduction current density, which is the current which is flowing on the surface of the conductor, and as well as there is a displacement current density JD, which is the current flowing inside the dielectric. That means the field, the electric current divides into two. One is JC, other is JD. Okay. So now JC is nothing but your J sigma, I will say, where sigma is the conductivity of the conducting material, which can be written as sigma into E. This already you know, sigma is the conductivity of the material, which is copper, and E represents the electric field at this particular point. And because of the displacement of the charges, you get what is known as the JD, the displacement current density, which is given by dou D by dou T. I think you already know the Maxwell's equation. Okay, what is Maxwell's equation? Del cross H is equal to J plus D dot, isn't it? We are applying this only. Okay, J plus dou D by dou T, right? So I think you all know J is the conduction current density, which is given by sigma E. Okay, and plus dou D by dou T, D is equal to epsilon E. I think you all know this. And dou by dou T can be replaced by J omega. If I am assuming that phasor representation, this dou by dou T can be represented as J omega. So in that case, this will be J omega epsilon E. Okay, sigma E plus J omega epsilon E. This is known as the modified Ampere circuital law. Okay, so if you integrate it, you are going to get two things. Del cross H is equal to J plus dou D by dou T, which is sigma E plus J omega epsilon E. So this part gives me the conductance current density due to the current flowing on the surface of the conductor, and this portion gives me the displacement current. So that's why I am splitting this as JC and JD. This is JC part, this is your JD part. Okay, so J omega epsilon E is your displacement current, and J sigma E is your conduction current. Then there is a phase angle difference between the conduction current and the displacement current, which we are representing it as it by tan theta. So tan theta is given by, now you can see here, this is your x-axis, this is your conduction current. Normally the displacement current will be 90 degree out of phase with respect to conduction current. So that's why you see there is a 90 degree phase lag here. And the resultant current is the sum of the conduction current plus the displacement current. So for that, I am drawing again a vector from the point O to this particular point. Okay, so to find out the resultant vector, what we do is, if I say this angle is theta, this angle will be 90 minus theta. Okay, please remember, this angle will be 90 minus theta. Okay, now what I want is, I want to find out this tan theta. Okay, I want to find out the last tangent. So last tangent will give me what is the nature of the substrate material, how much lossy it is. Okay, to do that, I have to find out what is known as the loss tangent. Loss tangent will give me an information about the phase angle difference between the conduction current and the displacement current. To do that, this is your sigma E vector from here to here. This is your sigma E from here to here, and this is your J omega epsilon E. So this sigma E can be represented, written as here. This will be sigma E only. When I draw a straight line parallel to this, such that it starts from the tip of this vector and ends at this particular point, again draw a resultant vector. So tan theta will be opposite side by adjacent side, that is sigma E divided by J omega epsilon E. So finally, I can say tan theta is equal to sigma divided by omega epsilon. So theta will be equal to tan inverse of sigma divided by omega epsilon. So this is the phase angle difference between the conduction current density and the displacement current density. And it gives a lot of information about the nature of the substrate material that you are looking at. Okay, so you can see here alpha D. Now the attenuation constant due to conductor, due to dielectric loss taking place inside the dielectric substrate, is given by alpha D. alpha d is equal to sigma by 2 into square root of mu by epsilon. This is expressed in meters per centimeter, where mu is the permeability of the material, epsilon is the permittivity of the material. Now again, what you can do is you can find out the tan theta value. Tan theta value is equal to sigma divided by omega epsilon, because you take tan inverse here, it will be tan theta, which will be sigma divided by omega epsilon. Now substitute the value of tan theta, which is equal to sigma divided by omega epsilon. Let us try to modify this equation such that we can insert this into equation number 1. To do that, so what we will do is sigma is equal to omega epsilon tan theta, isn't it? So in that case, now you express the sigma in terms of omega epsilon tan theta. Substitute this value of sigma in the expression for alpha d. So alpha d, you already know it is sigma by 2 into square root of mu by epsilon. Sigma is equal to omega epsilon tan theta, then alpha d becomes equal to omega epsilon tan theta by 2 into square root of mu by epsilon. So this is your expression for alpha d. Okay. Again, you further simplify this. So when you further simplify this, what I can do here is, you know, alpha d. Okay, alpha d is omega epsilon tan theta by 2 into root of mu by epsilon. So what you can do here is, you can represent this epsilon as, I can write this epsilon as equal to root epsilon whole square. If I write this epsilon as equal to root epsilon whole square, okay, that means I will write it here better. If I write this as root epsilon whole square, this is same. Then this one root of epsilon gets cancelled with this root epsilon. So what you get in the numerator is omega root of mu epsilon tan theta into omega by 2, or omega into root of mu epsilon tan theta by 2. Okay. So one epsilon gets cancelled. This will be omega into root of mu epsilon tan theta by 2. Okay, this is what is written here. So this is expressed in meters per centimeter now. Okay, now you have found out the expression for alpha d. So next is again there is a dielectric filling factor in terms. So normally what happens is there is a package density associated with the dielectric. So for example, I can make the dielectric filling factor high or dielectric filling factor low. Okay. Just like doping concentration, which you have in the semiconductor material, highly heavily doped and lightly doped. Likewise, you have you can change the value of the dielectric filling factor. That means number of atoms packed per unit area or unit area of your dielectric substrate. That is known as the dielectric filling factor. So if more number of atoms are going to be present per unit area of your substrate, then the dielectric filling factor will be high. Okay, so that normally the dielectric filling factor gives information about how many atoms are packed per unit area, okay, of the dielectric. Okay, that is known as the dielectric filling factor. So the dielectric filling factor is given by Q. So in terms of the dielectric filling factor, I can represent this alpha d as 4.34 into Q sigma by epsilon re into root of mu naught by epsilon naught. Okay, this is how you find out the alpha d value. So again, what you can do is you can again try to simplify this. Root of mu naught into root of mu naught by epsilon naught is nothing but your velocity of light, which is equal to, this is equal to approximately 3 into 10 power 8. Okay, 3 into 10 power 8 meter per second. And again, what you can do is express it in centimeters, no problem. 3 into 10 power 10, you will get it. Then again, what you do is multiply this with 4.34, and further simplification, it gives you 1.634 into 10 power 3, okay, into Q sigma by root epsilon re dB per centimeter. So this is what you are going to get. So when you substitute for this velocity of light, so this is what you get, where sigma represents the conductivity of the dielectric and epsilon naught and mu naught represent the absolute permeability and absolute permittivity and permeability of the medium. So this is expressed in dB per centimeter. Okay, you have to take again dB, convert it into dB. Again, dielectric filling factor is given by this equation. So which is epsilon re minus 1 divided by epsilon r minus 1. Where epsilon r is the effective relative permittivity of the dielectric, because as the electric fields propagate along the surface of the dielectric, there will be an interaction of the electric field lines with the dielectric. So what happens is the permittivity is going to be changed from epsilon r to epsilon re. So q is given to epsilon re minus 1 divided by epsilon r plus minus 1. This is how you define the directive filling factor. Okay, so again epsilon re is the effective permittivity of the substrate. So substitute this, and you know sigma is equal to omega epsilon tan theta. Substitute this in the expression for alpha d. You get alpha d is equal to 1.634 into 10 power 3 q omega epsilon tan theta divided by root epsilon re. Again, I can write this omega as equal to 2 pi f. So this is same as equal to 2 pi into c by lambda naught. Okay, because f is c by lambda naught. Again, I can represent it as 2 pi c by lambda naught. Lambda naught can be represented as lambda naught is equal to lambda g. Lambda g is the guide wavelength. Okay, so once the signal enters into the microstrip line, there is a guide wavelength lambda g, which can be written as lambda naught by root epsilon re. Lambda naught by root epsilon re. So then in that case, lambda naught will be equal to lambda g into root epsilon re. Lambda g into root epsilon r, this will be 2 pi c only. Okay. So in that case, again, alpha d changes to 1.634 into 10 power 3 into q into 2 pi c by lambda g root epsilon r into epsilon naught epsilon r by root epsilon r into tan theta. So you know already c is the velocity of light, which is 3 into 10 power 8 meter per second. Epsilon naught is 8.85 into 10 power minus 12 farad per centimeter. Sorry, farad per meter. After you express this, substitute for these values. And again, if you simplify this, you are going to get the expression for alpha d as 27.3 q epsilon r by epsilon re into tan theta by lambda g dB per centimeter. So this is, please make sure that it is capital B, okay, not small b. This is dB per centimeter. This is also dB per centimeter. So this is the expression for the attenuation constant due to dielectric losses, and it is a function of the loss tangent that takes place inside the dielectric, that is tan theta, then dielectric filling factor, then relative permittivity, effective permittivity, and guide wavelength. So these are the parameters on which the alpha d depends on. Next, what we can do is, again, we can simplify this further. Okay, we can express this lambda g as lambda naught by root epsilon re, and again, lambda g is equal to c by f. Lambda naught is c by f, so c by f into root epsilon re. Substitute this value in the expression for alpha d, you get alpha d is so we have just defined lambda g here. Lambda g is lambda naught by root epsilon re, and again lambda naught is c by f. Next, we will see, this is the graph which shows the variation of the dielectric filling factor q epsilon r by epsilon root epsilon r as a function of width to height ratio. So what you observe here is, this is the width to height ratio, which is represented along x-axis, and this is q epsilon r by root epsilon r, which is along y-axis. So we have taken different substrates of different permittivities. What you see here is, as the width to height ratio increases, let us say from 0.1 to let us say 2, in steps of 0.2. Okay, so what happens is 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, you see that at low, for lower values of width to height ratio, okay, this factor q epsilon r by root epsilon re will be very small. Okay, and again, as width to height ratio increases, you see that this value also increases. So it becomes, it changes from 0.88 to 0.92. Okay, and as the permittivity changes, increases, that means when you go for higher dielectric constant materials, you see that the variation is much, much lesser. And again, for if you take a very high dielectric constant material, I think the behavior, the alpha d will be almost, I can say, constant. Irrespective of the width to height ratio, it will be having a constant value nearing to 0.98 or 0.99. Okay, so not more than that. So what I can say is, there is a dependence of this factor on the width to height ratio. So as the width to height ratio is lesser, then this factor will be lesser. As the width to height ratio increases, then Consequently, this factor Q epsilon r by epsilon re also increases, and it changes from 0.88 to 0.92 for this particular case. Epsilon r is equal to 6. So this is the variation of the filling factor, okay, as a function of W by H. So what you can conclude is the dielectric filling factor is a function of the relative permittivity and width to height ratio. This is a very important thing. And if loss tangent is frequency independent quantity, the attenuation constant alpha d is also happens to be a frequency independent quantity. This is another inferences that you can draw. Next, we'll go to the low ohmic losses. So ohmic loss primarily result because of the current flowing on the surface of the copper conducting strip. You have a copper conducting strip. So once the current flows, there will be I square R loss, okay, on the surface of the conductor. Okay, that gives rise to what is known as the ohmic losses. So now this loss takes place both on the ground plane as well as on the surface of the conductor. So this is the current distribution on the surface of the conductor. This is the current distribution on the at the bottom of the strip. This is the current distribution on the top of the strip. This is the conducting strip. This is the current distribution on the top of the strip. This is the current distribution on the bottom of the strip. What you see here is current is nearly minimum at this point, and but is having maximum value at the edges. Okay, so this is what is the current distribution. So the current density is mainly present at approximately a skin depth inside the conductor. Skin depth means approximately 1/E or 37% of its original value. Okay, so that means if I say this here, it is having a very high value. 1/E approximately is the skin depth. So approximately at this point, the current is going to be concentrated, okay, on the surface of the conducting surface. So with the minimum value at the center and maximum value near the ends. But whereas in the ground plane, again you see that current will be maximum at the center and minimum near the ends. So what you can see here is the current densities are not uniform on the surface of the conductor and the ground plane. So here there is a current maxima point in the ground plane, but here there is a current minima point on the surface of the conductor. So that is why current densities are not going to be uniform. And as the frequency of operation increases, there is a skin effect. Skin effect means the tendency of the current to flow on the surface of the conductor. Okay, that is known as the skin effect or skin depth. So what happens is because of this effect, the surface of the conductor gets heated up because most of the charges are going to be flowing on the surface of the conductor. So assuming current distribution to be uniform, the conductor attenuation constant for a wide macrostrip line is given by this equation. Alpha C is equal to 8.686 RS divided by Z naught into W, where W represents the width of the conducting strip, Z naught represents the impedance, okay, and RS represents the surface impedance. Or surface resistance. Z naught represents the characteristic impedance of the line. RS is the surface resistance. Again, it is a function of three important parameters, F, mu, and sigma. The frequency of operation, mu is the permeability, and sigma is the conductivity. Conductivity means here we are considering the conductivity of the copper conductor, okay, that we are looking at. So RS is equal to square root of pi F into mu by sigma, which is the surface skin resistance in ohm per square centimeter. And again, RS is given by 1/ delta sigma in terms of skin depth, where delta represents the skin depth in centimeters. And it is again given by root of 1 divided by pi f into mu sigma, or 1 divided by square root of pi f into mu sigma. This is the skin depth. Okay, so normally at high frequencies, the current will be flowing in this skin depth. Okay, with this skin depth. So again, you see here, this is the variation of the attenuation factor. Dielectric attenuation factor alpha d as a function of width to height ratio. So as you can see here, as the alpha d value, alpha d into rho, okay, alpha d into rho, rho is a resistivity, okay, alpha d into rho value as it varies, okay, then with respect to W by H, for smaller width to height ratio, you see that alpha d value is very small. But as the width to height ratio increases, the attenuation constant increases. Attenuation constant due to dielectric losses increases. This is for one particular substrate, which is gallium arsenide. For silicon, the permittivity is 11.8. Again, you see, as the width to height ratio increases, okay, then what happens is the alpha d value is also going to increase. That means I can say that the attenuation constant due to dielectric loss are going to be increasing as the thickness of the dielectric substrate increases. Okay, as the thickness and the width, okay, as when both the width and the thickness, that means it is directly proportional to the width to thickness ratio. As the width to thickness ratio increases, okay, you see that the attenuation constant due to dielectric loss also is going to increase. So next is radiation loss. So radiation losses primarily depend upon the substrate thickness, dielectric constant, and geometry of the microstrip transmission line. So radiation loss is given by P radiated by PT is equal to 240 pi square into H by lambda naught whole square into F of epsilon RE by Z naught, where F of epsilon RE is given by this equation, epsilon RE plus 1 by epsilon RE minus 1 divided by 2 epsilon RE root epsilon RE ln root epsilon RE plus 1 divided by root epsilon RE minus 1. So this is the radiation loss. This radiation loss takes place because some of these electric field lines are coupled from the conductor to the ground plane, and some of these electric field lines are going to be radiated into free space. Okay, so this is known as the radiation losses, P radiated, and you can see that it is a function of two important quantities. One is the H, the substrate thickness H, and the effective permittivity is also a function of effective permittivity, which is given by this equation. So as the effective permittivity F of epsilon RE increases, obviously radiation losses are also going to increase. As the substrate thickness increases, again radiation losses are also going to increase. So this is the variation of the conductor attenuation constant as a function of width to height ratio. For alpha c, as you all know, it is 8.8686 rs divided by z naught into w. So this is going to be plotted with this rs is alpha c z naught h by rs. This is the constant that is taken along y axis, and this is the value which is taken along x axis w by h. As you can see, as the width to height ratio is very small, this ratio, width to height ratio. Okay, so what you observe here is the alpha c value is very large because there is a lot of attenuation that is going to be taking place on the surface of the conductor because the width is very small, and at high frequency, as I have told you, current flows mainly on the surface of the conductor. So area will be very small, so obviously losses will be very high. So conductor strip gets heated up very early. Okay, but as the width to height ratio increases, what happens is, that means if you make the strip more and more wider and increase the thickness as well, then what happens is the conductor losses are going to progressively decrease. So for this case, it is going to change from 40 to approximately, I can say 1.5. Okay, so this is for this particular case when T by H is equal to 0.02. T is the thickness of the conducting strip. Okay, H is the thickness of the dielectric substrate. Okay, again, when this factor is kept constant with the different values, you see that the variation will be again different. So you should understand the difference between alpha d and alpha c. Okay, alpha d is going to increase as the width to height ratio increases, but alpha c is having reverse characteristics. As the width to height ratio increases, alpha c decreases. So this is the inference that you should draw. So radiation losses decreases when the characteristic impedance increases, and for low dielectric constant substrates, radiation is significant at high frequencies. But for higher dielectric constant materials, radiation becomes insignificant and until very low impedance levels are reached. Next is quality factor. Quality factor is another important parameter which tells us the extent of loss that takes place inside the microstrip transmission line. And normally it gives an empirical expression for the selectivity, okay, the losses that takes place inside the microstrip transmission line. Because microstrip transmission line is also a frequency selective device, you can say. It passes a particular frequency and rejects unwanted frequency. So normally high quality factor accounts for radiation losses. If the quality factor is very high, then radiation losses are also equally very high. So normally quality factor of a microstrip line is very high. So we will try to derive an empirical expression for the quality factor. Again, the quality factor is divided into two. Okay, because there are two different losses that take place. One is alpha c and alpha d. So corresponding to alpha c, you have qc, which is the quality factor due to conductor losses, and corresponding to alpha d, you have qd, which is the quality factor due to dielectric losses. Now the quality factor due to conductor losses is given by QC, which is equal to 27.3 by alpha C, where alpha C is the attenuation constant due to conductor losses. Substitute the value of alpha C as 8.686 RS divided by Z naught into W, where W is the width of this microstrip line, RS is the surface resistance. So if you substitute this in the expression for QC, and also you have Z naught. So Z naught is also known to you. If the microstrip line is very wide, you can approximately assume Z naught as equal to 377 by root epsilon r into h by w, or h by w into root of mu by epsilon. Mu is nothing but mu naught into mu r. Epsilon is equal to epsilon naught into epsilon r. When you take the ratio, it comes out to be equal to 377 by root epsilon r into h by w. Okay, where 377 or 125 is the intrinsic impedance of the free space. So now you can see here, substitute the value of these parameters in the expression for QC, you get QC as equal to 27.3 into alpha C is nothing but 8.686 RS divided by Z0 into W. So Z0 into W goes to the numerator. Okay, and again, Z0, you know, it is 377 by root epsilon R into H by W. Substitute this value here. Again, we can try to do some more simplifications. Okay, I can substitute for epsilon R. So for substituting for this epsilon root epsilon R, what we can do is lambda G is, you know, already guide wavelength, which is the wavelength which is propagating inside a microstrip transmission line. So lambda G can be written as lambda naught by root epsilon R. And again, lambda naught is equal to C by F. So again, this can be represented as 30 by F in gigahertz. Okay, that gives you lambda naught in centimeter. Substitute this value here. Okay, so we can again try to derive an empirical expression for root epsilon R. So lambda G is 30 by Fg into root epsilon R. So root epsilon R will be equal to 30 by Fg into lambda G. Got an expression for root epsilon R. Okay, now what you can do is substitute the value of root epsilon R in the expression for Z0. You get 377 by root epsilon R. Root epsilon R is nothing but 30 into Fg into lambda G. Okay, 30 into Fg into lambda G. So Fg into lambda G goes to the numerator and you have H by W as usual. So Z0 will be changed to 377 into Fg into lambda G by 30 into H by W. So this is the characteristic impedance that you get it. Again, you further simplify this. Okay, so QC will become equal to 27.3 into W divided by 8.686 RS divided into 377 lambda G Fg by 30 into H by W. Finally, QC comes out to be equal to 39.5 into H by RS into F in gigahertz. H is the substrate thickness, RS is the surface resistance, Fg represents the frequency in gigahertz. Now you can substitute for RS. RS is known as the surface resistance, okay, which is again given by root of pi F into mu by sigma, okay, which is can be written as pi F into mu naught into mu R by sigma. Again, you can substitute for RS as 25 into root of F in gigahertz divided by sigma. Sigma is a conductivity. So again, substituting this part here, okay, you get the QC as equal to 0.63H into square root of sigma into F in gigahertz, where sigma represents the conductivity of the copper, okay, which is 5.8 into 10 power 7. F is the frequency in gigahertz. So again, if you substitute the value of the conductivity of the copper, this is sigma value. This value is your sigma. Sigma value. Okay, sigma is 5.8 into 10 power 7. Substitute here, you get quality factor due to conductor as 4780H into root of F in gigahertz. So this is the expression for quality factor due to conductor loss. Now we will look into quality factor due to dielectric loss. Quality factor due to dielectric loss is given by this equation QD is equal to 27.3 by alpha D, where alpha D is the attenuation constant due to dielectric losses. Alpha D, you already know, alpha D is given by 27.3 into Q epsilon R by epsilon R into tan theta. Okay, so substitute this value in the expression for QD. You get QD as equal to 27.3 divided by 27.3 Q epsilon R by epsilon R into tan theta. Now what happens is, this 27.3 gets cancelled here. So this 27.3 gets cancelled here with this 27.3. So then in that case, what happens is, we'll be left with QD as equal to epsilon R divided by Q epsilon R tan theta. Okay, so this is what is going to be remaining for you. Again, what I can do is epsilon R, epsilon R, so the dielectric filling factor Q can be represented as epsilon R minus 1 divided by epsilon R minus 1. Again, I can approximately write it as equal to epsilon R by epsilon R. Okay, if there is not much difference, normally effective permittivity and relative permittivity will be very small. Effective permittivity will be slightly less than the relative permittivity. So in that case, we can approximately assume that when you subtract it, the ratio will be more or less equal to epsilon R by epsilon R. Okay, so in that case, substitute the value of this Q as epsilon R by epsilon R, then this epsilon R gets cancelled with this epsilon R. So what you have here is epsilon R also cancels with epsilon R. So finally, you will get, so this value, when you substitute this here, QD is equal to epsilon R divided by epsilon R by epsilon R. So this epsilon R goes to the numerator into epsilon R tan theta, isn't it? You have epsilon R tan theta. चलो नॉट टेन थीटा, so when you try to simplify this equation, epsilon r gets cancelled, epsilon r gets cancelled, so finally you will be left with 1 by tan theta. So I can say that the quality factor due to dielectric loss is directly proportional to 1 by tan theta, that is 1 by loss tangent value. Okay, so let us now, students, let us take some small quiz on whatever concepts you have learned today. So first question is, the quality factor due to dielectric loss is directly proportional to the loss tangent, inversely proportional to the loss tangent, proportional to the square of the loss tangent, or none of the mentioned. As I've already told you just now, QD is equal to 1 by tan theta, isn't it? So it is approximately equal to the reciprocal of the loss tangent. So the answer is option B. It is inversely proportional to the loss tangent. The attenuation constant due to conductor loss increases with increase in the quality factor, decrease with increase in the quality factor, is independent of the quality factor, and none of the mentioned. So please, students, think about it. So I told you, attenuation constant due to conductor loss is given by what? Alpha C, isn't it? So alpha C is related to the quality factor by what equation? 27.3 by alpha C, isn't it? So in that case, alpha C is inversely proportional to QC, or QC is inversely proportional to alpha C. So the attenuation constant, when the attenuation constant due to conductor loss, it increases with increase in the quality factor. That means if I say, if this increases, quality factor decreases, isn't it? It decreases. If it decreases, the quality factor is going to increase. So the answer is option B. Okay, that means the attenuation, as the attenuation constant due to conductor losses decreases, the quality factor due to conductor losses increases, QC increases. So the answer is option B. Next, our question, as the substrate thickness increases, the radiation losses increases, decreases, remains unchanged, none of the mentioned. So as I have told you, radiation losses are a function of the substrate thickness. So as the substrate thickness increases, definitely the radiation losses are going to increase. So the answer is option A. As the substrate thickness increases, radiation losses are going to increase. Fourth, a substrate has a dielectric loss tangent of 0.002. Its quality factor is 200, option A, option B, 30, option C, 400, option D, 500. So again, here the correct answer is QD is equal to 1 by tan theta. Tan theta value they have given as equal to 0.002. So then in that case, it will be 2 by 1000. So it will be 500. So answer is option D. So if the width of the microstrip line increases, attenuation constant due to conductor losses decreases, remains unchanged, increases, none of the mentioned. I told you alpha C is given by 8.686 RS divided by Z naught into W. So it is inversely proportional to W, isn't it? So as the width increases, what happens then? As the width increases, okay, you see that alpha C should decrease. Okay, so the answer is option A. Summary. So in today's class, we discussed about the loss that takes place inside a microstrip transmission line. Okay, there are three different types of losses. One is the conductor losses, the dielectric losses, and the radiation losses. Conductor losses primarily depend on the width of the conductor. Okay, it is given by alpha C, which is equal to 8.686 RS divided by Z naught into W. That means as the width changes, as the width increases or width changes, alpha C is going to be accordingly affected. Okay, so you have seen the variation of the conductor loss. As the width to height ratio increases, conductor loss are going to decrease with increasing width to height ratio. Next is dielectric loss, alpha D. Alpha D is another important parameter. So you all know the dielectric constant alpha D. Okay, it is a function of the loss tangent, isn't it? It is a function of loss tangent, and as the loss tangent changes, definitely the attenuation constant due to dielectric loss is also going to change. We have seen as the width to height ratio increases, alpha D is definitely going to increase. So as the thickness increases, more and more dielectric loss are going to be taking place inside the substrate, and radiation losses are again a function of the thickness of the substrate. As the thickness increases, radiation losses are also proportionately going to increase for a thicker substrate. So this is what we saw. Then we saw that the attenuation constant due to conductor loss primarily depends on these factors, RS, Z0, W, skin depth, And another important thing is, at high frequency, most of the current is going to be focusing or concentrated on the surface of the conductor. So it will be 1 by E. It will be, the current density will be at a height of 1 by E from the surface of the conductor. It will be flowing at that particular point. Okay. So that is one thing. There is a skin depth associated with the flow of current on the conductor surface. Next, also we saw the dielectric filling factor is another important parameter. So alpha d is a function of the dielectric filling factor, which is given by epsilon r e minus 1 divided by epsilon r minus 1, which is a function of effective which is the ratio of effective permittivity to relative permittivity. And the radiation loss depends on the substrate thickness, the dielectric constant, and the geometry. So the ratio of the radiation resistance to the characteristic impedance represents a small fraction of the power that is going to be radiated. So that's what we saw just now. So quality factor was another important thing. So quality factor, we saw two different quality factors. One is quality factor due to conductor loss, and quality factor due to dielectric loss. As you all see, quality factor due to conductor loss is going to be a function of alpha c. It's 21.3 by alpha c. Again, as the alpha c value decreases, quality factor is going to increase. And again, quality factor due to dielectric loss is directly proportional to 1 by tan theta. So it is a function of loss tangent. So as the loss tangent value increases, quality factor is going to decrease. Okay. So these are the things that we discussed in today's class. The next class, we will look into the parallel strip lines and the coplanar strip lines, and we will try to derive the equivalent circuit of it. We will try to derive an empirical expression for each one of these parameters, and we will look into what are the factors affecting the performance of these microstrip lines, that's parallel strip lines, and where they are going to be used. That is their application part. So thank you for your patient listening. So thank you.